Listening Library presents The Summer of the Swans by Betsy Byars. Read for you by Alyson Silverman.
Chapter 1. Sara Godfrey was lying on the bed, tying a kerchief on the dog Boise. "Hold your chin up, Boise, will you?" she said, as she braced herself on one elbow. The dog was old, slept all the time, and he was lying on his side with his eyes closed while she lifted his head and tied the scarf. Her sister Wanda was sitting at the dressing table combing her hair. Wanda said, "Why don't you leave Boise alone?" "There's nothing else to do," Sara answered without looking up. "You want to see a show?" "Not particularly." "It's called The Many Faces of Boise." "Now I know I don't want to see it." Sara held up the dog with the kerchief neatly tied beneath his chin and said, "The First Face of Boise, proudly presented for your entertainment and amusement, is the Russian peasant woman. Ta-da!" "Leave the dog alone. He likes to be in shows, don't you, Boise?" She untied the scarf, refolded it, and set it carefully on top of the dog's head. "And now, for the second face of Boise, we travel halfway around the world to the mysterious East, where we see Boise, the inscrutable Hindu. Ta-da!" With a sigh, Wanda turned and looked at the dog. "That's pathetic. In people's age, that dog is 84 years old. She shook a can of hairspray and sprayed her hair. "And besides, that's my good scarf." "Oh, all right." Sara fell back heavily against the pillow. "I can't do anything around here." "Well, if it's going to make you that miserable, I'll watch the show." "I don't want to do it anymore. It's no fun now. This place smells like a perfume factory." She put the scarf over her face and stared up through the thin blue material. Beside her, Boise lay back down and curled himself into a ball. They lay without moving for a moment, and then Sara sat up on the bed and looked down at her long, lanky legs. She said, "I have the biggest feet in my school." "Honestly, Sara, I hope you're not going to start listing all the millions of things wrong with you, because I just don't want to hear it again." "Well, it's the truth about my feet. One time in phys ed, the boys started throwing the girls' sneakers around, and Bull Durham got my sneakers and put them on, and they fit perfectly. How do you think it feels to wear the same size shoe as Bull Durham?" "People don't notice things like that." "Huh. No, they don't. I have perfectly terrible hands. Look at my fingers. Only I don't go around all the time saying, 'Everybody, look at my stubby fingers. I have stubby fingers, everybody,' to make people notice. You should just ignore things that are wrong with you. The truth is, everyone else is so worried about what's wrong with them that it is very difficult to ignore the fact that you have huge feet when Bull Durham is dancing all over the gym in your shoes. They were not stretched the tiniest little bit when he took them off, either. You wear the same size shoe as Jackie Kennedy Onassis, if that makes you feel any better." "How do you know?" "Because one time when she was going into an Indian temple, she had to leave her shoes outside, and some reporter looked in them to see what size they were. She leaned close to the mirror and looked at her teeth. Her feet look littler. That's because she doesn't wear orange sneakers." "I like my orange sneakers." Sara sat on the edge of the bed, slipped her feet into the shoes, and held them up. "What's wrong with them?" "Nothing. Except that when you want to hide something, you don't go painting it orange. I've got to go. Frank's coming." She went out the door, and Sara could hear her crossing into the kitchen. Sara lay back on the bed, her head next to Boise. She looked at the sleeping dog, then covered her face with her hands and began to cry noisily. "Oh, Boise,
Boise, I'm crying, she wailed.
Years ago, when Boise was a young dog, he could not bear to hear anyone cry. Sara had only to pretend she was crying, and Boise would come running. He would whine and dig at her with his paws and lick her hands until she stopped. Now, he lay with his eyes closed.
Boise, I'm crying, she said again. I'm really crying this time. Boise doesn't love me.
The dog shifted uneasily without opening his eyes.
Boise, Boise, I'm crying. I'm so sad, Boise,
she wailed, then stopped and sat up abruptly.
You don't care about anybody, do you, Boise? A person could cry herself to death these days, and you wouldn't care.
She got up and left the room. In the hall, she heard the tapping noise of Boise's feet behind her, and she said without looking at him,
I don't want you now, Boise. Go on back in the bedroom. Go on.
She went a few steps farther, and when he continued to follow her, turned and looked at him.
In case you are confused, Boise, a dog is supposed to comfort people and run up and nuzzle them and make them feel better. All you want to do is lie on soft things and hide bones in the house because you are too lazy to go outside. Just go on back in the bedroom.
She started into the kitchen, still followed by Boise, who could not bear to be left alone, then heard her aunt and Wanda arguing, changed her mind, and went out onto the porch. Behind her, Boise scratched at the door and she let him out.
Now quit following me.
Her brother Charlie was sitting on the top step and Sara sat down beside him. She held out her feet, looked at them, and said,
I like my orange sneakers. Don't you, Charlie?
He did not answer. He had been eating a lollipop and the stick had come off, and now he was trying to put it back into the red candy. He had been trying for so long that the stick was bent.
Here, she said, I'll do it for you.
She put the stick in and handed it to him.
Now be careful with it.
She sat without speaking for a moment. Then she looked down at her feet and said,
I hate these orange sneakers. I just hate them.
She leaned back against the porch railing so she wouldn't have to see them and said,
Charlie, I'll tell you something. This has been the worst summer of my life.
She did not know exactly why this was true. She was doing the same thing she had done last summer. Walk to the Dairy Queen with her friend Mary, babysit for Mrs. Hodges, watch television. And yet, everything was different. It was as if her life was a huge kaleidoscope, and the kaleidoscope had been turned, and now everything was changed. The same stones, shaken, no longer made the same design. But it was not only one different design, one change. It was 100. She could never really be sure of anything this summer. One moment she was happy, and the next, for no reason, she was miserable. An hour ago she had loved her sneakers. Now she detested them. Charlie, I'll tell you what this awful summer's been like. You remember when that finky Jim Wilson got you on the seesaw? Remember that? And he kept bouncing you up and down, and then he'd keep you up in the air for a real long time, and then he'd drop you down real sudden, and you couldn't get off, and you thought you never would? Up and down for the rest of your life? Well, that's what this summer's been like for me. He held out the candy and the stick to her.
Not again.
She took it from him.
This piece of candy is so gross that I don't even want to touch it, if you want to know the truth.
She put the stick back in and handed it to him. Now, if it comes off again, and I mean this, Charlie Godfrey, I'm throwing the candy away.
Chapter 2. Charlie looked at the empty sucker stick, reached into his mouth, took out the candy, and held them together in his hand. Sara had said she would throw the candy away if this happened again, and so he closed his fist tightly and looked away from her. Slowly, he began to shuffle his feet back and forth on the step.
He had done this so many times over the years that two grooves had been worn into the boards. It was a nervous habit that showed he was concerned about something, and Sara recognized it at once.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.